Hi, good morning. Don't worry, nothing to worry about. I love you too. Hi, welcome back. So I'd like to introduce someone who needs no introduction, but I'll do it anyway. Sean Aker, our beloved head TF. And he's going to lecture today on ethics. It's a great topic. And he's going to lecture again next week. We're also going to have a few guest lecturers in the second half of the semester, all extraordinary. And the most extraordinary of them all is speaking today.
Thank you, Tal. Hey. Thank you. I haven't even done anything yet. This is great. I think Tal asked me to give a lecture on ethics this morning because I think he knows a secret about me, a secret I wasn't hoping to share. I think Tal knows that I was, and probably always will be, a Boy Scout. Not just a Boy Scout, an Eagle Scout. And everyone knows that a Boy Scout is trustworthy, loyal, helpful, friendly, courteous, kind, obedient, cheerful, thrifty, brave, clean, and reverent. Who better to give a lecture on ethics than a Boy Scout? And what better place to begin a lecture on ethics than to begin by being honest? So let's be honest. I am a huge, huge liar. Not only am I a liar, but I'm also sometimes unethical. There's so many times I could tell you about it. I actually started at a young age. When I was just 7 years old, I really wanted a Ghostbuster action figure. My parents would buy it for me. So when we went to Target, the first thing I did is I walked to the toy store section, the toy aisle, picked out the toy that I loved and wanted so much, got the package, opened up the package, took the toy, put it in my pocket, put the package back on the shelf, so it'd be neat, and went to find my dad. And then as we were walking out into the parking lot, I craftily took the action figure out of my pocket and threw it in front of us. I said, oh, look, Dad. What extraordinary luck. Exactly the toy I had wanted. I immediately had to return it. Or there was a time when I really wanted to watch Stephen King's It. How many people have seen Stephen King's It? It's scary. It's really scary. It's a precious movie about a bloodthirsty demonic clown who terrorizes children before eating them. I brought a picture of one today. There's Stephen King's It. Of course, I couldn't watch Stephen King's It alone. No, not after the terrible showing I had crying during the scary parts of Care Bears the movie. So I asked my sister if she, well, I tried to encourage my sister to watch the movie with me. And I encouraged her by telling her, well, Amy, if you just keep watching this movie just a little bit longer, you'll see the scene with the unicorns. She loves unicorns. And now she's terrified of the circus. Yes, I'm a liar, and I'm unethical, and I'm a terrible liar. Like the time when, I hit the most home runs in a major league season while on designer drugs. And then there was that time when I defrauded thousands of investors out of millions of dollars and then gave huge severance packages to all my rich friends. This year, I told people I cloned a human. I bit a guy's ear during a boxing match. I invented BlackBerry. I told people the levees would hold. I hooked up with an intern in the Oval Office. I had a sleepover at the Neverland Ranch, and I told people there are weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. So let's be honest. This is actually really fun. Let's be even more honest. Sometimes, most times, I get away with it. After all, aren't most of our unethical decisions merely just rational gambles that have the potential of paying off? Think about it. We speed because it's faster, unless, of course, we get caught by a cop. Then it's much slower. It takes more time. But what are the chances of that? It's a gamble. Or some people evade their taxes. It saves money unless you're audited, then it costs more money, right? It's a gamble. Or we lie on our resumes to get jobs we want. Or we cheat on tests in order to get the grade that we deserved. I mean, if we had actually studied. We lie and tell our friends that we'd actually been on a date. Or we download Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants to save money and embarrassment at the video store. It can become an addiction as long as our logic and our cognitive patterns lead us in the direction of continual corner cutting. But we all know this. We already know this. We already think that it's probably better to be ethical than unethical, that it's good to be good, and that ethical leadership is probably better than unethical leadership. So why do we need to talk on ethics in a course on leadership then? Let me ask a few questions. Just raise your hand if you already, before hearing my talk, already believe that it's better to be ethical than to be unethical. Okay, let the record reflect. It's almost everyone in here. How many people in here think they would live a better life, they'd be a more effective leader, they would live a more fulfilling life if they were more ethical than ethical? Just raise your hand. More ethical than unethical. Okay. Well, that's a pretty resounding endorsement of the ethical life. And Tal, I don't have anything else. I mean, there's not really... One more question. How many people feel like the people that lead our country, the CEOs of our multinational corporation, and our political leaders got there because of their extraordinary moral sense? Just raise your hand. Okay, well, maybe that's an unfair question. How many people have done something unethical? Just raise your hand. Okay, well, everyone makes mistakes. How many people did something unethical in March? Spring break. All right, how many people have done something unethical already this week? Today, in lecture. It's actually very difficult to be unethical in Sanders, I mean, without wireless internet. But you guys are extremely illogical, right? On the one hand, you're telling me that you live a better life, you'd be happier, have more friends, and be a better leader if you're ethical. Why in the world would you be unethical? Well, I think underlying every unethical decision are two assumptions. The first assumption is that it's a shortcut to success. No one would choose the unethical route if it took longer and took more work than the ethical route. For example, I once spent months trying to decide how to rob a bank, then go through the dangers of actually stealing $1 million from a bank, and then have to hide from the cops afterwards, if the alternative was somebody legally just giving me $1 million. No one would choose that route. The second assumption is that the advantages outweigh the disadvantages. We either think we won't get caught, or we think that if we do get caught, the punishment will not be too high to outweigh the advantages we just received from being unethical. And the advantages to being unethical are a lot. First is speed of success. Fastest way to get to the things you want is to go around the ways that we normally have to. Profit, higher profit margin. This is how people make so much money. Path of least resistance. It's the easiest way sometimes. Sometimes being ethical takes more time and it's just harder. Equity, since other people cheat, we have to cheat. That's the prisoner's dilemma, right? And the last part is, there are no disadvantages if we don't get caught, right? This is the great part, is you can actually go through all of this and not have any disadvantages whatsoever. Well, the potentials for the success of the unethical alternative are literally as old as time, from primordial parables of Eve tempting poor, poor, gullible Adam, to sordid stories of Enron defrauding millions, thousands of investors out of millions of dollars. And while every religion has argued fervently against the unethical alternative, only now has science, psychology, and economics caught up to the point where they can actually provide an academic grounding and basis for rejecting the unethical alternative. Not because of an external, all-seeing judge, but because every single one of the advantages proffered by the unethical solution are straight up false. Seriously, if all these advantages were actually true, I'd be giving a very different talk today. I'd be giving a talk about unethical leadership for dummies. And I think the result of that type of leadership would look something a little bit like this edited version of Bush's State of the Union.
During these last few months, I've been trained by Al-Qaeda, and I'm weak and materialistic. I told our country and I told the world, if it feels good, do it. I hope you'll join me in expressing fear and selfishness. We will embrace tyranny and death as a cause and a creed. We can be summed up in one word: evil.
Obviously, this is an edited version, and I don't want to. Obviously, Bush is arguing everything opposite of this. I just want to say that because I have a couple other pot shots from later. I think after hearing this talk, I don't want to give in to the temptation of calling them dummies. But I think after hearing this talk, we can only call the unethical uneducated. For it is clearly the unintelligent decision based upon all the research that's at our disposal. My lecture today will revolve around 3 points. What does it mean to be ethical? Why does being ethical matter? And how do we become more ethical? I think the unethical alternative is attractive for many ways, yet all the psychological research we have says that it's a terrible investment. I actually calculated some of the percentages this morning of different probabilities. The chance of winning in the Powerball lottery, 1 in 36 million. Chance of correctly predicting the entire NCAA basketball brackets, 1 in 36 trillion. Chance of doing something unethical without suffering a cost, priceless. Or 0 in 36 trillion billion million. That's accurate. You write down all that. 0 in 36 trillion. But the reason why is being unethical, every time you are unethical, you suffer a cost. At least in Powerball, you have a chance. Every time you perform an unethical action, you have an internal psychological cost that you bear, even if you're never caught. Case studies will demonstrate that's not the worst part, actually. The worst part is not only do you experience this, but you can cause a complete breakdown in the ethical climate around you. Case studies will demonstrate how even the perception of being slightly cutting corners or being slightly unethical dramatically decreases productivity, morale, success rates, health, and profitability. More important, in the realm of leadership, poor ethics spread. Ethics are highly contagious, and one leader can transform the entire ethical climate, as we'll see with several of the case studies during the rest of the lecture. We'll get to all this point, dramatically decreasing profitability, causing people's health to plummet, but we'll talk about that once we figure out exactly what it is that it means to be unethical. So we'll do that in part one. So come with me. Oh, hello. Welcome to part one. Part one of our talk is Transcending Intuitive Ethics, and I'm Sean Acor. I'm going to think a lot of people are going to disagree with my stance on ethics, but I think that part of what I'm going to be arguing is against viewing ethics in terms of a way of I'm not going to go down today and tell you different actions that are ethical and unethical, but rather, I believe that we all have an intuitive moral compass within inside of us. As some of you may know, I attended Harvard Divinity School, and as you might well expect, I attended Divinity School mostly for the power, money, and women. But while I was there, I also got an opportunity to study a little bit of Christian and Buddhist ethics. One of the things that really interested me in all the religions that I got to study, there's constantly a conflict, a tearing between knowing what is right and wanting to do what is right. We try and weasel and trick our brains into thinking that what we want to be right is what is actually right. There are extremely difficult ethical debates out there that I can't even touch on today. Abortion, capital punishment, torture during war. These are all cases of lines. If we cross the line, then we know whether or not we've been ethical or unethical. For example, if we know that capital punishment is murder, then we know not to do it, because murder is wrong. The question is whether or not it's crossed that line. But the important part is that we actually recognize what is right and wrong, even if we don't know where the line is. So this is the part I think people will disagree with. For the most part, we may know what is right or wrong. I think we automatically do. We have a code that's written upon our hearts. Or in psychological terms, we have a socialized set of intuitive ethics which govern our cognitions. For example, even a criminal sitting in a prison who has been unjust in the society, if you give ice cream sandwiches to all the other inmates, that inmate will then tell you that they've been treated unjustly. Cheat a cheater, lie to a liar, rob a thief, the same result. We have intuitive moral compass that tells us what is just and unjust. So let me make this clear. I'm not going to tell you what actions are ethical and unethical because I believe that they're common sense. I think that's why a lot of ethics talks fail, is because they waste time telling you, be honest to your clients, don't defraud people, be nice to people, don't steal my stuff. These are obvious because they're intuitive ethics. And what is important is why we don't do what we know we should do, what the effects are, and how do we change. We also intuitively know what we want in a leader. I didn't buy this part when I first read it. At the beginning of the semester we read Kirkpatrick, who argued for different types of traits that leaders have. And one of the things he said was crucial to being a leader is integrity. Well, I laughed out loud at that part, and people at Starbucks started moving away from me. And I took out my black highlighter of disdain and started marking through it. But I found this study by Den Hertog, which said, it was a multicultural study, it went across 60 different countries, sending 15,000 different middle managers, and what they found is the number one positively endorsed leadership attribute across the board is trustworthiness. That people equate being trustworthy with being a leader and not being trustworthy with not being a leader. We intuitively know exactly what type of leader we want. I think that you can be ethical and still be immoral, in the sense that I think ethics is just following your values, but your values might be skewed. They themselves might be immoral. So let me define it and refine it a little bit. I think that what we're talking about here is something I would call transcendental ethics. Transcendental ethics are ethics which transcend our selfish desires. Or as Jim Collins, who wrote Good to Great, the best leadership, or the most well-known leadership book we have out there, that the best leaders are servants who subjugate their own needs to the greater ambitions of the group around them. Finally, and interestingly enough, you may remember when I said earlier that CEOs and political leaders sometimes are immoral? Well, I think we could have included some of our religious leaders in that group. Sometimes some of our TV evangelists, some of the clergy, have done things that have been immoral. What they did is, Druscat actually handed out a multi-factor leadership questionnaire, which assesses leaders based upon all the characteristics that we've talked about in this class, all the biggest tenets of leadership research that's out there. And what they found when they gave this survey out is that spiritual leaders, the monks, the nuns, the priests, and the Catholic Church in the United States, all scored higher on average, scored higher than the CEOs, who had been embroiled and inculcated within this leadership research, exactly like we've been. We've been learning about all this information, but the people that seem to be successful, the ones that are rated highest as being transformational leaders, were the people that weren't focusing on those things, but were focusing instead on a spiritual success. What I think that means is that people deep down want something that transcends just our selfish desires, that we want organizational values that extend beyond it and root us in things of compassion, and joy. People in the corporate and political world are not feeling this. And if you're going out into the corporate and political world in the next year or in the next couple years, remember this stuff. Here's Homer Simpson talking about the plight of the modern American worker.
If you don't like your job, you don't strike. You just go in every day and do it really half-assed. That's the American way.
Embedded in this idea is the idea that a lot of workers are feeling cognitive dissonance. Remember, cognitive dissonance is where you feel a disconnect between the values that you feel and the actions that you're performing. A lot of organizations have values within them or act in ways that are contrary to the ways the workers actually feel. And when this happens, people feel a disconnect from their work. And you can see this and feel this when a lot of people talk about going into jobs where they feel like they're selling their soul. They recognize this intuitively. Mitroff and Dinan called this the divided soul of corporate America. And sadly, Rinesh and his studies found that the majority of American workers actually feel cognitive dissonance in their work. This is extraordinary and something to keep in mind if you're going to be a leader leading people that are out in the workforce who feel this way. The results of this are quite deleterious. Dissonance decreases morale, productivity, and successful completion of tasks. I'll talk about this in part three. But before we do that, I want to talk about part two, which is, I think, is my favorite part of the speech. It's the psychological toll of lying and being unethical, even when we don't get caught. So let's move there. Of course, you're all thinking all the disadvantages I'm about to talk about stem from the fact that we actually get caught or somebody is suspicious that we're actually doing wrongdoing. But what happens if no one knows? I mean, what happens if we don't even get caught? We may not get caught. But to the argument that because we're not caught, we won't see any disadvantages, psychology argues quite the opposite. Many of you have seen, actually, when I was studying this, I saw there's a lot of research on lie detector tests, on the autonomic nervous system, and on ethics, but no one's making the connection that we should be ethical for the rationale that it causes huge stress upon our system. Most of you have seen, probably, Meet the Parents, where Ben Stiller is hooked up to a lie detector test by his father-in-law, who's just trying to enervate him before and keep him from dating his daughter. He was also CIA or FBI. So let's watch this scene really quick.
Yeah, I shouldn't.
Well, why should you be afraid? You have nothing to hide.
No, I know.
I know you know, so there shouldn't be any problem.
No, there's no problem.
Oh, try it on.
Okay.
I'll help you. Don't worry. You'll enjoy this.
Right. Looks complicated. Now, these aren't 100% accurate, right?
Well, you'd be surprised how accurate they are. They can tell fairly easily if someone's lying or not. Now I'm going to ask you some questions, and all you have to do is answer yes or no.
Okay.
All right. Let's give it a whirl. Did you fly on an airplane today?
Yes, I did.
No peeking. Did we eat pot roast for dinner tonight?
Yes.
Was it undercooked?
No, it was rare. It was a little rare for my taste. But I was
kidding. I'm just... Relax. The needles are jumping. Have you ever watched pornographic videos?
No. I mean, well, I don't...
Yes or no?
Okay. The reason why lie detectors work is because they're calibrated to record internal stresses that are felt by the liar. In other words, our bodies recognize when we take the unethical route, regardless if our brain is telling us, no, we actually need to tell a lie in this case. This has a lot of different implications, and most of the implications relate to the fact that it causes autonomic nervous system stress. Let me give you a quick bio refresher to explain why this is so important to leaders. Being unethical increases and activates the autonomic nervous system. The autonomic nervous system is an involuntary part of our nervous system which causes automatic reactions. There's a sympathetic nervous system. This is the arousing part, the part that causes us to have the fight or flight response. And there's the parasympathetic nervous system, which is the part that calms us down. When we tell a lie, we activate the sympathetic nervous system, which arouses our body, which causes the lie detector test to go up and down, like we were seeing it with Ben Stiller there. On the right-hand side, you can see what the sympathetic response system does to the body. It dilates the pupils, causes us to have dry mouth, which is why in movies with like criminals and Law and Order, they're always asking for like a glass of water. Most of the time, that's because they're lying. Accelerates their heartbeat, their breathing becomes more shallow, as opposed to the parasympathetic response, in which case you have a slower heartbeat, it's easier to breathe, etc. The problem is the sympathetic nervous system is catabolic, which means that it depletes your body. It depletes the energy that you could have been using for elimination of waste and nutrients and digestion and for energy for doing other activities, and wears it actually down. This would be analogous to putting all of our resources of a nation into just military spending, right? It's great in times of an emergency, but we get behind. Our body and our nation becomes out of balance when we don't take preventative and restorative measures such as education or health insurance. This is not so bad, but it gets much worse. When we choose the unethical route repeatedly, if it becomes part of our job, if it becomes a habitual pattern for us, if we find that we have to hide from things we've done, it causes something called the sympathetic response dominance. The sympathetic response dominance, which is where we respond automatically by activating our sympathetic nervous system. This is also what I call the Soprano effect. How many people watch The Sopranos? I love The Sopranos. It's amazing. How many people watch Lost? It has nothing to do with that, but that's also very good. The Soprano effect, in the Sopranos show, if you haven't seen it before, Tony Soprano, who's sitting there in the therapist chair, is a mob boss. He's this tough guy, but he has to hide his nefarious deeds from, partly from his family, from his friends around him, from the law. So he's constantly feeling this internal stress, and as a result of it, he's become out of balance. So much so to the point that he has this sympathetic response dominance, causing large amounts of anxiety. He actually passes out several times from the anxiety, and clinical depression. He actually has to have antidepressant medication. So the entire premise of the show, I've only seen the first season, is, at least the first season, is dominated by the idea that he actually has to go into therapy, even though he's a mob boss. I think a couple other movies have done that too. Here's the problem with that. The negative effects of the Soprano effect are fatigue. Now remember, keep this in mind when we're talking about all the advantages of being unethical. These are the disadvantages of being unethical, and you can't stop them, right? This automatically happens internally, regardless of what our brains have rationalized. If we feel that what we're doing is wrong, if we feel the autonomic nervous system responses that you were seeing with the lie detector test, you get fatigue, blood clotting, high cholesterol. You don't need to write all these down. It'll be on the website too, but you won't need to know necessarily all these. Fatigue, blood clotting, high cholesterol, heart disease, stroke, chronically tense muscle, which causes pain in the back and neck, anxiety, depression, insomnia, obesity, increased sensitivity to pain. In other words, if you choose the unethical route, you increases your chance of being overweight, unhappy, and sick. And it doesn't matter if we're even trying really hard not to have this effect, right? If we try and convince ourselves that we don't actually feel this. Watch this clip from The Simpsons. You could see Mo dealing with this problem. Actually, I'll tell you what happens. It's not that funny. he said, does anyone know this part really? He just says, he's hooked up this lie detector test, and they're like, did you kill Montgomery Burns? He goes, no, and he goes, ding, and then says, oh, good. Well, he's like, well, unhook me. I need to go. And he's like, well, because I have a hot date tonight. He goes, He's like, odd date, dinner alone, and he goes through all these different scenarios, and he's like, fine, I'm going to hoggle the girls in the Victoria's Secret catalog, Sears catalog, ding. Now unhook me. I don't deserve this treatment, So that's the idea. This was much better than actually watching The Simpsons. I do this every Wednesday night if anyone's interested in watching this. It's a gamble. This is all, right, all those terrible side effects are if the gamble works, right? If you're not caught, right? That's what happens. It's probably even worse if you don't get caught, right? Because that stress is constantly there and you're constantly hiding. But I want to talk about what happens when the gamble actually fails. Now, I'm not actually going to spend a lot of time talking about when things really go bad for you, right? When the gamble completely fails. We know the consequences. If you're speeding on the way to the airport and you get stopped by a cop, you miss your flight. WorldCom and Enron went bankrupt. Martha Stewart did hard time. Milli Vanilli had to return their Grammys. Saddam was found in a hole in the ground. O.J. Simpson did hard time. Well, you get the point. Even a perception of wrongdoing decreases trust and therefore decreases consumer confidence. But let's say the gamble fails, but only slightly. Nobody who's an authority figure who can punish us finds out. And no one we're trying to hoodwink finds out. So we get away with it. The only people that know are our friends and our coworkers. Many of you say that this wouldn't be that bad, right? Let's say that the coworkers don't decide to quit working for you because of, well, they've heard part one and part two of my speech about if you're unethical, you increase the chance of becoming overweight, unhappy, and sick. So they stay with you. You're still screwed, scientifically, for several reasons. But let's go through the reasons about why you would still do the unethical choice, even despite the stress. You might be thinking, it's just stress, I can sort of handle stress. Well, here's the rationales. We'll do all the rationales about why you'd actually want to be unethical, and every single one of them is wrong. And by the end, in the next 5 to 10 minutes, you will actually not have a leg to stand on for making any unethical decision. You might say, it's a quick way to get ahead. Or you'd make more money, or I'm just one person, it doesn't really matter. The little stuff doesn't matter, I just don't do the big stuff. It's just one time. These are really good arguments. I've made all of these, several of these, mostly today, even today. And the problem with all of these is that they're all terribly, terribly wrong. Let's go through them. The first one is it's a quick way to get ahead, you know? Being ethical takes a lot more time sometimes, and I have a lot of other things I can do. So I can be unethical, cut some corners here, and it gives me time to really do the things that matter, like hang out with my friends or hang out with my family. No, actually, that's false. It actually decreases the chances of success. Brian Little, who does research on personal projects and personal psychology, has participants do a project dump where they describe all the projects that they're actually currently working on, and then has them rate it in terms of satisfaction, how well it correlates with the values that they hold, how much success that they feel like they've been having so far. What he found is the projects that had low self-identification, meaning that you don't identify who you are with the action that you're doing, have a very low chance of success. Good ethics, however, on the other hand, are like self-concordant goals. If you think about what I was saying earlier about the cognitive dissonance that workers feel and that Homer was talking about, is if you feel a disconnect between your work and the values you hold, you feel a lower self-identification with your task. When you feel a lower self-identification with your task, you have a decreased chance of success. However, self-concordant goals are goals and actions that correlate with the values that we actually hold. And those have the highest chance of success because of increased mood, endurance, and drive. But Sean, you make a lot of money. A lot of people that make a lot of money have done so because they've done something unethical. They get the money and then, hey, I'd have the money then to be more ethical, right? It'll save money in the long run. No, you lose money. A lot of money. Worker surveys were passed out to 3,000 different workers in dozens of different firms, and one of the things that they found is that they found that low integrity in the senior leaders caused a higher increase in turnover rates and training costs. What this means is that a lack of integrity of the senior leader, What they found is that if a senior leader was moral, they found that the person leading their organization or their class or whatever it is was moral, then they had a 40% chance of being extremely loyal to that company. If, on the other hand, they felt like their leader was unethical, only 6% of the entire company or organization felt loyal to the company. That's dramatic because that means that you're 7 times more loyal to a company if you feel that the senior leader is ethical. that has a lot of implication in everything from the sports that we play to the nonprofits that we're running to the organizations we might be running someday. 7 times more loyal. But what does that matter? I mean, if you get the job done, why does it matter if they're loyal? Well, Mayfield and his studies found out that high levels of loyalty actually increase productivity by 11%. And those of you in economics know that increase in productivity by even just 3% has huge ramifications by 11% across the board. And they found that low integrity also correlated with a 34% increase in the turnover rate. Now, some of you have expressed interest to me in terms of studying psychology. I'm going to be studying, getting my PhD in psychology as well, hoping to look at the correlations between positive psychology and leadership and the business workforce. And if you're interested in doing this, these ideas, if you took these ideas and ran with it, these are worth hundreds of millions of dollars, this idea up here, right? Because companies spend hundreds of millions trying to retrain employees, which takes them time. They have to go out and find employees when employees aren't loyal to a company. If you can teach a company to have their senior leaders be more ethical, you increase the loyalty of all the people working for them and save a ton of money. You can say, but Sean, I'm just one person. You know, like, it's an entire organization, entire class, entire sport, entire team. Why does it matter if I'm ethical? I'm just one person. I'm not that important. Well, no. Yes, you're one person, but your mom was right. You are the most important person. The reason is that the leader has the most dramatic effect and influence upon the ethics of the people that follow them. This is really interesting. If you're the captain of a sports team, the ethics of the people that are on your sports team are more highly correlated with your ethics than with the rest of the peers on the team. That means that the leaders are the ones that are actually creating the ethical environment which they're in. But Sean, it's so small. I just make sure that I don't do the big things. I won't do the things that are really unethical. I'll just do the small little stuff. It's just small stuff doesn't matter, the big stuff does. Nope, it's just the opposite, actually. It's the small stuff that have the largest implications. How many people have read Malcolm Gladwell's The Tipping Point? It's really good. And read Blink, too, if you get a chance. Malcolm Gladwell's Blink. But this one's coming from Malcolm Gladwell's Tipping Point. And in this, he talks about the broken window theory, which is really cool if you haven't heard about it. He says in this, he's describing what was happening in New York, where violent crimes in New York on the subway system were skyrocketing. And so New York really wanted to do something to prevent this. So what they did is they hired a whole bunch of law enforcement agents in order to try and decrease the felonies. So they attacked just the people who would be doing the felonies. What they found after they spent all this money is that the felonies went up. There were more felonies. Well, no one knew what to do until somebody offered this idea called the broken window theory, which sounds very spurious. It sounds a little Care Bear. The idea is that, well, you know, maybe people are doing bad things because there are broken windows, you know, or maybe because there's graffiti. So they actually took this idea. They went and changed all the broken windows on the subways. They stopped people from jumping over the turnstiles. What, they lose a dollar? They stopped people from doing that, so there weren't people that were, like, getting away with the system. And they painted over all the graffiti. And when somebody paint more, they just paint over it again. You know what they found? They found the felonies dramatically decrease. And the reason is that the small ethical decisions we make have lasting implications for how, for example, if you have small unethical decisions or things that seem to make it look like New York doesn't seem to care, then the small parts, the culture of things don't seem to care, is actually what feeds and encourages somebody when they're deciding whether or not to do a felony, to do the felony. What stops them is they say, oh, people are taking nice care of this. This is not a good place to do a felony, I assume. Well, Sean, it's just one time. I'm going to be unethical once, and that's it. I'm not going to be unethical anymore. I'm just going to do this one time. No, this is wrong again, too. The reason is single and small unethical decisions have global implications. This is coming from Friendly Fire. Scott Snook came and spoke to us. He was a great speaker. One of the things that, well, he wrote this book on Friendly Fire, which describes how two Black Hawk helicopters got shot down while carrying VIPs in the no-fly zone in Iraq by American jets. And so the military did all this, these trials, the court-martialing, they try to find out who's to blame for these helicopters getting shot down. And they couldn't find anyone to place the blame on. Not the subordinates who had signed off on or the officers who had signed off on it, not the people that were flying around up above in the surveillance, not the people who actually fired the missiles and the jet fighters, no one. So what Snook describes is he actually argues what happens is that there is an issue of practical drift, which occurs in organizations. Practical drift is where somebody creates a rule, and then when it gets implemented in reality, it gets changed. People start cutting corners. When one person starts cutting a corner to be more efficient, and it is more efficient, other people start to cut corners as well to be more efficient. It's more efficient sometimes to not do what all the rules say. The problem comes when the situation arises which the rule was originally created to reject, in the case of which happened with the Black Hawk helicopters. So in other words, going for efficiency oftentimes does not have the actual effect that we would want for it. I'm a little bit ahead of schedule, so I just wanted to tell you a story that I thought was interesting that wraps up a lot of these different ideas. And in keeping with the idea of how unethical I've been since 7, or probably even before that, I was part of I was a camp counselor at this camp. It was this Texas Governor's Honors Program, and they have counselors and they have people that are 1 to 2 years younger than them. And my sister was actually there at the camp, and she's going to hate me after I told this story and the one at the beginning. But she was 2 years younger, and I was very protective. I was a junior in high school, and she was a freshman. And this boy liked her, the most popular boy at the camp. He was this really tall, tan guy with blonde hair called Graham. And I didn't like him at all. And I know that he and my sister would often sneak off to the dark room, this room that everyone knew was going off to make out with people. And I knew what they were doing. They were going to make out with my sister. And so I didn't like this. So we had family groups, family units, and I was in charge of my family. And it was a group of boys, and we hung out and lived together. And so what I did is I had two of my boys. I gave them some flour, and while I was off giving a talk in front of everyone else, so I clearly wasn't in trouble, they went about and floured his room, because I had keys to all the rooms as well. So what that means is you put flour everywhere so the room comes completely white. Everything on his half of the room became white. There's somebody else living in there. So anyway, we came back. I came back from my talk, and I see all this commotion going. Graham's there, and he's standing at the door, and he's looking in, and he's crying. And I'm like, oh, no. And one of the adult counselors came by and said, don't cry. Whoever did this is a man enough to cry about. So I took Graham aside. It's like, Graham, I'm really sorry that this happened to you, and I don't know who did this, but I have a feeling like it was some of my boys, and I want to take the credit for it. He's like, Sean, you're such a good guy. I was like, yeah, yes, yes. So I walked out. Within an hour, the entire camp had found out about it, and all the girls of my little sister's age were walking around going, oh, he's so ethical. He was going to take the credit for it. And every time I was like, oh, my sister came up. She's like, thanks for being such a good brother to Graham. Well, I told her later on, and I still have the bruises to prove that. But the interesting thing is that after I made this decision, no one knew but my boys, right? No one knew this. My boys who had done nothing, my family who had done nothing wrong the entire time were there, suddenly became extremely unruly. Two of them actually got kicked out of the program after this, and none of them had done anything wrong. This is in the last week of the camp. And what happens is they saw a senior leader doing something unethical, something small, but it caused deviations to spread into the larger things because it created a culture that no one really cares about what's ethical. So let's talk about how to change. If we want to become more ethical, what do we have to do? Fortunately, ethics are a result not of being inherently good or bad. You're not inherently good or bad, but by habit cultivation. They're practiced. They're socialized. So there's three things we can do. The first is ethics are created only through habit and socialization. So just like we're doing habits, some of the sections are doing habits where you want to learn about one thing or you want to practice doing one thing. You can actually make ethics a habit. This is called social engineering. And social engineers create the environment which actually cause the habits to be formed. John Dryden says that first we make our habits and our habits form us. So listen, I want to encourage you, and we'll do it together. For the next week, starting from right now, for the next week, we'll all try this together and we'll talk about it in our sections. I want you to try as hard as you can to not lie. Just try as hard as you can to not lie. And every time you do, try and remember it and write it down. Put a little tick mark. And if you're having too many pages, just do it on the computer. Or if that's something that's too easy or too hard for you, just go 3 days without talking, saying anything bad about somebody else, or a week. Try this. Try and create a habit, and you'll see how very difficult it is. But the good part is the small changes like this have radical, exponential growth patterns. In the sense that if you change your words, you can change your actions. And when you change your actions, you change your habits. And when you change your habits, you change your character, which changes your destiny. The second is that, and related, you can create intervening mechanisms. Just like the nation at the governmental level creates ways of disincentives or incentives for causing ethical and unethical behavior, such as sin taxes, where you increase the tax that's put on cigarettes, or you, what's another example? You could, you can increase the punishments on drunk driving, right? Or you can do good things. You can increase tax incentives for having people give away money. What they've done is they've created mechanisms in places where they know people are having trouble. You can do this for yourself. Just as you can do energy patterns and energy journals where you plot over the course of your day where you feel the most energy and where you feel the troughs, like I feel really energetic at this time of the day, but don't feel energetic at this time, and then you plan your study around that, same thing you can do actually with ethics. Find out when and where it is specifically that you find that you're being unethical or you feel a disconnect between your beliefs and your actions. This is similar to the work that Brian Little was doing with personal projects. And when you do this, you have a huge opportunity to cause and strategize a war against the places where you feel like you're being unethical. And the last thing is just want to know. Want to know where you're being unethical and want to know if other people are being unethical doing the things you want them to do. A majority of people that were surveyed by Morgan in 1993 said that not only are there not rewards that are in place for people that are more ethical, there seems to be a reward system for people that are unethical that get things done very quickly, and more importantly, the superiors don't want to know. And when the superiors don't want to know, they just want to know the outcome and don't want to know how you do it. That is what increases the unethicality, whatever, the unethicalness. Other people become more unethical because of the fact that the superiors don't actually want to know. So want to know about that and want to know about yourself. Ask people for questionnaires included in the 360 feedback. This last point dovetails with a lecture I'm going to be giving next week on transcendental leadership, which is leadership that seems to transcend the ways in which we actually exist and interact with the world. So I'll save the rest of it for then. But to summarize, I've argued that we have an intuitive set of ethics, that we feel right and wrong, which is how lie detector tests actually work. And we know that even if we're not caught, there are huge disadvantages in terms of the autonomic nervous system effects and the soprano effect, which we saw, and it causes huge amounts of fatigue, insomnia, and the health problems that are involved with that. Moreover, every single one of the advantages, all the rationales we have for being unethical have been proven to be wrong, right? Psychology has given you the rationales for every time you come up and rationalize why you should do something unethical, why you shouldn't actually do it, why your thinking is flawed. Now, if you're interested in studying this, over the summer and over the next year, I'll be researching this, and if you'd like to get together with me, I'm actually going to have a meeting within the next 2 weeks where I'm going to invite people who are interested in studying business or psychology or ethics and are interested in finding ways to make this idea marketable to businesses and have the potential of getting published in terms of academic journals. If you're interested in joining me with this, I'd love to have you and love to talk to you about that. But aside from that, I hope you guys have a wonderful week. Thank you for listening, and thank you for being a great audience.